Welcome back. This is the second episode of Matt and I's series where we explore bringing cards specifically from the Legacy format into Modern. We're trying to see what effect that they would have on the format, whether or not they're too powerful, whether they're powerful enough to see play, all those sorts of things. In the last episode, we explored Food Chain, which I think had some interesting results. And this week, we're going to be exploring a sort of a classic Legacy card that's probably or that's waned in popularity over the years, and that card is Goblin Lackey. So Goblin Lackey is a really powerful card that lets you cheat on mana. For the uninitiated, it's a 1-mana 1/1 goblin, and whenever it deals combat damage to a player, you can take a goblin from your hand and put it directly into play. So it's a little bit of a ritual effect in a type of deck that normally doesn't get that, so that's pretty cool. And the card in Legacy was always pretty interesting because it was paired with some pretty powerful effects like Aether Vial and Wasteland and etc. Some of those tools aren't available in Modern, so the decks do have to be built quite a bit differently, but we still have some exciting things to share with you guys today.
Yeah, I've really been looking forward to this card when we were discussing different cards we could talk about, you know, what we're going to film in the first two or three episodes of the series. This one stood out to me, because it's taking a card out of Legacy that's probably not tier one in Legacy right now. A goblin's strategy exists in Modern, but clearly not even tier one or tier two. And so can we combine that element that, and Lackey requires you to be a linear strategy, not just goblins, but high casting cost goblins. And what happens if they just path or bolt that Lackey? Will things fall apart? So we're going to explore these ideas today, these constraints, right? The deck building constraints about how do I put expensive goblins like Siege Gang Commander into my deck and still have a modern playable deck. Constraints like what happens if I don't draw Lackey, or if Lackey doesn't survive and I don't get to untap with it. We haven't played the games yet, but I suspect these things will come up. When it comes together, how strong is it? When it doesn't come together, how well do the rest of the pieces hold down the fort while we wait for the next game where maybe Goblin Lackey does show up on turn one or does live to turn two? So I have an intuition that this card is not too powerful for Modern and that it's fun, but you just don't know until you sit down and play the game. So that's what has me pumped up about this week.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think we're going to find that the format is pretty naturally insulated against this card anyway. There's a lot of 1-mana removal spells running around, like Lightning Bolt and Path to Exile. And then even the Arclight Phoenix decks are naturally playing Gutshot right now anyway. So I think it's probably okay from a power level perspective, but this is the kind of thing where, we could totally be wrong about putting a Siege Gang Commander into play on turn two. The format's not really set up to deal with things like that right now.
Yeah, it's interesting because there's a sense in which, look, if you can't kill the 1/1 that humans puts out or the 1/1 that spirits puts out on turn one, like, you're probably not faring all that well in those matchups either. So that's part of it. And yes, people are preparing for the tournament expecting to have to kill all sorts of small creatures that, again, that humans deck or a spirits deck or otherwise might put out. On the other hand, yeah, are those other decks as fast as Goblin Lackey attack you, drop a Siege Gang? I mean, probably not. So yeah, this is what makes it interesting, but it's not coming as out of left field as the Food Chain deck was. Well, now the Food Chain opponent is facing cards like Food Chain and Mist Hollow Griffin that just weren't like anything else. They're quite different in kind. So this is a different approach or different question that we're posing to the format than the one that we posed in week one. So a nice contrast there as well.
Absolutely, yeah. I'm definitely excited to get into the games. I think we can hop into the deck techs now.
Let's do it.
Yeah, so what I'm showing here is the version of the deck that I had built. I had done some searching for Goblin War Chief in Modern, and one of the decks that had come up was something that was utilizing Collected Company. And the reason why that I was drawn to this strategy initially was because it sort of mirrors what was going on in the Legacy version of the deck a little bit. Goblin Lackey used to be paired with a guard called Goblin Ringleader, and that was a 4-mana 2/2 that when it came into play, you get to look at the top four cards of your library and draw all of the goblin cards that was in it. Collected Company is a very similar effect in the sense that it's, producing card advantage in this style deck. So I wanted to see if we could sort of replicate that strategy. The other thing that you'll notice about this deck is that instead of playing the really expensive goblins like Siege Gang Commander, which we've already mentioned, or even Krenko or things like Goblin Trashmaster, every single goblin that I have in this deck is able to be hit by Collected Company. So the idea here is that we can maximize Collected Company out of this deck and present a quick clock.
Clearly, in a strategy like the one that you're presenting, we're not going to need to draw the Goblin Lackey in order for things to come together. And my list, which we'll talk about, which is a little bit more aggressive, it's gonna maybe have to mulligan a little bit more often to try to find. Whereas your deck might just be able to go Goblin, 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 Collected Company, and do something that mirrors what a human's deck might do or something like that. So this is an interesting approach for sure. I like the fact that you're showing up again this week with a creature-based strategy around another card, like whether it's Court of Calling in your Food Chain deck or Collected Company here. You're not just saying, hey, I'm going to draw the perfect hand. You've got a backup plan baked in.
Yeah, absolutely. Collected Company just, it's a known playable card in Modern, and it helps out with tribal strategies like this quite a bit. Some other deck building things to talk about. You'll notice that there's a pretty large number of 3-drops, a total of 14 in this deck, which is quite a bit for Modern. But if you look at the rest of the cards in the deck, Skirk Prospector and Wily Goblin actually help get you to 3 mana a little bit more consistently than you would think with 22 lands in the deck. And they'll even help accelerate you to a quick Collected Company. That plus the fact that Goblin Lackey can help cheat in a Goblin Warchief, it means you can actually dump your hand pretty quickly with certain draws in this deck. And then on the card advantage front, again, this deck is playing the full 4 Goblin Rabblemaster and then a couple Legion War Boss as well. So, those cards putting tokens into play plus a Lord effect like Goblin Chieftain Goblin King can be pretty effective. Right now, I don't have Goblin King in this deck, but you could imagine a world where you add a couple copies of that in.
Awesome. So why don't we play some Magic now? I think you've seen the goblins. Most folks, I think, understand what Goblin Lackey's trying to do. I like the choices that you made, and now it's time to test it against 3 different Modern decks playing 3 different strategies, and we're going to see how the Goblin Lackey deck and the goblins around him will hold up.
Yeah, sweet. Let's get to it.
All right, everybody. Welcome to our first round of actual battles. We've got Eric across from me. He's going to be on the Lackey deck this round. And as me playing the role of villain, I've selected the Is It Phoenix deck as a popular and powerful deck to start out with.
Yeah, so it looks like we're starting out round one here on the draw, and I think this is a reasonable 7, so we're going to keep. It has a decent curve to it, as well as a card that's probably key in the matchup. Thing in the Ice seems like it might be another problem card for this deck, so being somewhat insulated that against that is a good thing. All right, going to lead off with a very powerful play, 1/1 haste, get in there.
So I lost the ability to be able to counter that lead. So that's unfortunate.
Well, I mean, that begs the question, should we do Mental Misstep during this series? Who knows?
Oh, interesting. Well, it's an interesting idea, if nothing else. All right, I'm going to play the card that Eric expressed. He expressed a combination of fear and comfort about the prospect of facing Thing in the Ice, but I'll play it anyways.
Yeah. So Matt knows our list here, and he knows that we don't have any lightning bolts in our deck. I think in a tournament setting, I'd attack into the Thing in the Ice in the hopes that my opponent would block, but it's not relevant here. So Goblin Pile Driver looks pretty good sitting across from blue creatures, but, this Metamorphose means that I might not have any creatures in play next turn. Let's see how big of a turn Matt has here.
What does this Metamorphose mean?
Oh, that means that means that things aren't looking too good for me.
Sleight of hand. And then I will respond to sleight of hand with... I'm going to get rid of the Pile Driver for good, since my plan to win this game is to attack with a 7-8 blue creature. Take that. This. All right, so good news, bad news for Eric. The good news is no Phoenixes. The bad news is 7-8 horror has awoken.
Yeah, so luckily we have a second Pile Driver here, which is going to give us a fighting chance this game. If Matt has a second Lightning Bolt effect here, we're not in a good spot. And this play does hurt a little bit, but I do think we need to have as much of a board presence as possible. I decided against it. Yeah, I'm just going to pass the turn here. And, you know, we're very, very unlikely to beat a Lightning Bolt anyway, but okay, so the turn passes back without the Pile Driver dying. That's a good sign.
Trying to think, do I want to take... Yeah, so I do have a Lightning Bolt. It's definitely getting bolted, but I didn't want to do end step because I might have been able to trigger a Phoenix. Now it's okay. I think I'd rather have this just in case. Play this out. Bolt that. The Phoenix plan didn't come together, but the bolt's there. And there we go.
Yeah, now we're not in a great spot. So, three cards in hand. I think we'd have a fighting chance if we drew a land this turn. But now we just need to make the play that's going to put us in the best position to win. So I'm going to take sort of a high variance play here, and we'll make one of these.
Okay, so I need to put a stop there. You have to control your stops against the Rabble Master because I plan on lightning bolting it.
All right, well, thing in the ice into triple bolt is going to be good enough to get us here.
Yeah, we're starting off this Lackey deck in an uphill fight against a deck with Lightning Bolt and a bunch of cantrips. And so, you know, I think we did this with Food Chain a little bit too, just saying, okay, well, let's not try to make it. Let's put real decks against it. Let's pick some decks that have cards that are interactive and potentially powerful, and that's fine. And we don't expect, the goal is not to see Goblin Lackey win three matches. It's to see how it does against decks that it's likely to face. And certainly, is it Phoenix one of those decks?
Yeah, and I think this is going to be one of the natural predators to any sort of Goblin Lackey strategy in Modern. So that game definitely played out as I expected. I think you had a pretty good draw, which helped things on your end, but it was nothing out of the ordinary, that's for sure. All right, so sideboarding for me, I think I'm going to bring in these Shaper's Sanctuaries just because all of the removal on Matt's side of the table is targeted based, and being able to sort of grind him out is a potential game plan. And then everything else in our sideboard looks pretty lackluster. Like Crater Maker nabbing an Arclight Phoenix probably is just not good enough. And then the question is, what do we take out? I think probably these Skirk Prospectors are not where we want to be in this matchup, or potentially even the Legion Loyalists. I think most of the blocking that Matt is going to be doing is with an 0-4. So the Indestructible Clause on here. The Trample Clause on here isn't super relevant just because, you know, his creatures are going to have pretty big butts. Yeah, so we'll trim a couple of those and submit.
I do like big butts. I don't intend to deceive you about that. All right.
Oh, man. So the question is, do we mulligan this hand? You know, it has the turn one Lackey, but not a ton to go with it. I think this card is probably pretty good in the matchup, but this hand just doesn't look like it has the power to get there. So I'm actually going to take a mulligan here.
Okay. I will keep seven.
I'm going to keep this. Do we want this? I actually think I'm going to bottom this. We're looking for a Lord effect with this hand. So let's lead off with this and pass the turn.
Okay. Prospector of Skirk. Alright, it's for me, it's going to be Steam Vents, Sleight of Hand. No surprises thus far. That guy. Skirk Prospector is going to eat a gut shot. So yeah, I mean, even when I was talking about how we kind of had an uphill battle here for the Goblin deck, Lackey, I mean, I didn't even mention, didn't think about Gutshot. I'm playing three Gutshot against Goblin Lackey, so this is going to be close to a nightmare matchup for the Goblin deck. It may not be competitive, and that's fine. It shows you kind of one of the ways in which it's poorly positioned, and I suspect in another matchup or two, we may see an area where it's well positioned.
Yeah, like you can imagine this deck having a decent matchup versus Tron, and if they don't like draw Wurmcoil Engine and play it on turn three, that sort of thing. Just because something like this can really run over a strategy like that. So I'm going to test this card out to see how it fares in this matchup. And we'll pass the turn back.
All right, so with Eric going for Shaper Sanctuary, he's indicating that with only two cards left, he's not going to be able to go in it with an overwhelmingly quick strategy. He's going to be kind of more grinded out, trade resources, kind of, and the Shaper Sanctuary allows him to do that. Whereas in game one, he obviously doesn't have that ability. I have in my hand a kind of counterpunch with Thing in the Ice, where now, if this isn't neutralized, I don't need to be in the business of targeting his creatures. I can simply be in the business of attacking for seven. I mean, and, you know, the Margot Marshall, among the best chump blockers ever made, but it may not be enough. So that's where I'm at with Thing in the Ice, just another powerful card. And really, my deck is kind of full of these powerful cards against a creature-based strategy. But Shaper Sanctuary, it's definitely going to have an impact of some kind. All right, so that's Manamorphos, that's Faithless Looting. Phoenix.
Yeah, so the option that I had to turn before is either play the Shaper Sanctuary or save the treasure token for the next turn and play a Goblin Rabble Master. I figured both of those plays are both pretty weak to Thing in the Ice, but I didn't see me, you know, being able to win the game through Thing in the Ice with either of those lines. So I chose the one that I thought was going to have better counterplay against removal spells, which I think your deck has more of. But, you know, having the turn two Thing in the Ice here is good.
Yeah, and I am going to give a Shaper Sanctuary card away because Mog War Marshal, it just presents so many blockers for Thing in the Ice that I'd rather put my opponent with one more card in hand and one fewer Mog War Marshal in hand. And that just seems fairly clear to me. I'm about to awaken this thing, no pun intended. All right, so now it's time to get in, and it's basically all over but the crying at this point.
Yeah, I think we're almost certainly dead here. If I had another Mog War Marshal to do some blocking, I think I'd feel good about this, but we don't.
You mean if I hadn't made the expert play of Lightning Bolt in that War Marshal? Is that what you meant to say?
Well, I mean, if you had lightning bolted me to the... Yeah, that was...
I'm joking.
Yeah, I mean, it was pretty strong. We do have the ability to block here, but this dies to so many things that it's almost, you know, it's almost like we're guaranteed to lose at this point. The reason why I chose not to play Rabble Master there is because of the clause on the card that's saying other goblins must attack if able. You know, it's very likely that, or basically guaranteed that I have to chump block using the Rabble Master this turn. But you can imagine a world where Rabble Master sticks around. Yeah, and this gutshot means we're dead. All right, so that match definitely went as expected, but...
We learned a lot. We learned that 1-1 goblins don't beat gutshot and really powerful creatures, like thing in the ice. Yeah, you know, again, at least it was quick. It was like ripping a Band-Aid off.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, here we are for round two. Round one was a pretty poor showing for the deck, and, you know, we got to see the power of Thing in the Ice and Gutshot versus a bunch of X1s. But round two, we're going to be playing against Dredge here. And if you go back and you look at the list, you'll notice that I basically showed up with no graveyard hate in the deck. So knowing that we're going to be facing against Dredge, we're going to be looking for a really quick clock. Looking at this opening seven here, I think this hand just barely makes the cut, knowing that we're playing against Dredge. It doesn't have a one drop in it, but we're going to keep.
All right, and I've got my Bazaar of Baghdad, so I'm going to keep. That was a little... A vintage joke. A vintage joke for the fans out there.
It's like every time I play against Dredge, they get to keep seven.
It is frustrating, isn't it? You think, yeah. Well, come on. Well, can't I be the guy that where they mulled it to? That's what happened to me in VSL. I played against Montolio playing Dredge, and he just mulliganed to oblivion, as we say.
Yeah, that was a wild match.
But not the case here. Here I've got a Dredge spell, a Faithless Looting, and a land, so not much of a head-scratcher here.
Yeah, so definitely one of the better starts for the modern Dredge deck. Turn one Faithless Looting is a pretty powerful play. Goblin Piledriver enables our quickest kills, which is why we decided to keep this hand. And it also gets to attack through Narcomoeba as well as Prized Amalgam because it has protection from blue. So that plus the fact that Blood Gas can't block means that this is probably going to be a problem card for the Dredge deck.
Okay, so I milled. I have an Amalgam. I have a looting that I had so that I don't have another Dredge or... All right, so as the Dredge player here, playing as Goblin Piledriver, game one, it looks like we're racing. And so the question here with my fetch, do I get the ability to play this life from the low magic Dredge, or do I get Mountain to keep my life total high? I feel like I'm in a spot with this hand where 2 points of life is slightly more likely to matter than the ability to loam. I've got other land in my hand, so I'm gonna fetch a Mountain, keep that life total high, and then I've got the Cathartic Reunion to get things started here. This land. All right, I'm gonna dredge a life from the loam, and I'm gonna dredge another life from the loam, and I'm gonna dredge a Stinkweed Imp. So I really wanted to hit a Narcomoeba because I've got multiple prized amalgams. I didn't do that. I hit a Creeping Chill, and so I'm not yet doing anything degenerate. I've managed to drain my opponent's life for three. Oh, that could have been accomplished a simpler way. I have a Blood Gas in the yard now, so it hasn't happened yet for me, but it's a matter of time.
Yeah. So looking at my hand now, obviously we were trying to draw our third land to play one of these Rabble Masters, and we didn't get there. But now we have an interesting decision to make. I think we're most likely to play the Wily Goblin this turn, just because we need the treasure token pretty bad. And the question is, do we want to use it to play the Lackey we just drew, or do we want to save it next turn to play one of these Rabble Masters to power up this pile driver? Looking at Matt's graveyard, there's... you know, he's got a Dredger right now, and he's going to have the ability to flash back a Faithless Looting, so he's going to see a ton of cards next turn, and I think it's very, very likely that he's going to hit a Narcomoeba. So playing this Lackey is probably not what we want to do with that very, very valuable treasure token. So
and I also have a Dark Blast. I just want to make sure that you see that as well.
I actually missed the Dark Blast. Yeah, so, I mean, that makes Lackey 100% the incorrect play then.
One of the annoying things about Dredge is not just that it's, you know, obviously hard to interact with in a game one, but also there's this zone with a pile of cards, and any one of them could matter, but most of them don't. It's a sort of annoying, I don't know. It's an annoying setup, obviously, but yeah, such is life.
It makes you think about things that you're not normally thinking about when you're playing Magic, and like that's sort of a tactical advantage for people who are playing Dredge, you know, especially in paper Magic. They're very, very comfortable with all of the, you know, sort of mechanics and thought processes that go into playing their deck while their opponent normally isn't. So what I've done here is I went and I popped out the graveyard so we can see everything a little bit more clearly. And Matt does hit the Narcomoeba here.
All right, and then we get to see another annoying feature of Dredge, a million prize amalgam triggers. So that's nice. We got to see a little bit of everything here. All right, I'm just going to get this blood ghast back just so I can show you guys some more triggers. What's the best way to not die? I think the best way to not die is to play a creature that can block Goblin Pile Driver favorably, so I will do that.
Okay, so Matt's had a pretty good draw here, but that's typical. You know, I'd say that this is a pretty typical draw for Dredge. And the question is, what's the best play that we can make this turn? Attacking into the Stinkweed Imp is going to be rough, just because he's going to have the ability to recast it every turn. And then he has 9, 10, 11, 12 power on board to attack with, even if he does block with the Stinkweed, which puts us on a two-turn clock. So the question is, what puts us in the best position to win? I think that's probably playing the Goblin Chieftain in hand over the Rabble Master, and then hoping as many creatures live as possible. Like maybe he makes port blocks, and then we draw another land next turn and play a Rabble Master, and then hope to fade Creeping Chills, which is pretty unlikely. And I think we attack in with this Wily Goblin here. It does represent a little bit of extra damage next turn when it attacks with the Pile Driver. But I think if Matt wants to Dredge a Stinkweed Imp and cast it next turn and use pretty much his entire turn's worth of mana that way, that's probably going to be okay with us.
Yeah, and I'm more than happy to just be able to Dredge 5 and maybe able to hit stuff like Creeping Chill, additional Blood Gas, whatever. So, and then just trade down on goblins. Not really seeing a path through for the goblin deck here, so it's a little bit of damned if you do, damned if you don't from Eric's side, and I'll go ahead and block with Stinkweed, go ahead and replay it, attack for a bunch, and just hope for the best. I'm going to send the Blood Gas because, yes, Pile Driver has a free block, but the Pile Driver already has 3 favorable free blocks, so what do I care?
Yeah, I think we need to keep the Chieftain around here, and we'll just absorb one of these Amalgams. Okay, so we did end up drawing the land, and the question is, do we have lethal this turn? I don't think we do with this Stinkweed Imp blocker, and...
Wow, you had lethal without the Stinkweed Imp blocker, though?
I think it might be close. So if I play a 22, so if I play a Rabble Master, that's an additional 3 power, plus the token is 2 more, so that's 5. And then the Chieftain is 2, the Pile Driver is 3, or...
No, the Pile Driver is like 6.
2 more, and then it's 1, 2, 3, 4, so that's 8 more on top of it. It was close, but...
Well, let's see it. I mean, attack with as much... I mean, you're dead if that's the case, but yeah. Attack with as much as you can, because I'm interested, because I was just surprised that you could deal as much as... Even if I was at 18 tapped out, I'd feel safe here looking at 2 creatures. So the fact that that's not the case is pretty interesting.
Yeah, I mean, the Pile Driver here is going to make... the attack pretty big.
Yeah, so... Well, so obviously, like, I have a block here, but let's say I didn't. We're looking at 8 and 2 is 10, 6 and 2 is 18. Yeah, so actually, yeah. had I been at 18, I would have been feeling secure, but I would actually have been taking lethal. You know, as luck would have it, I get to just block, but... Anyways, so that shows the explosiveness. Really, there was that was a 3-card combo, nothing wild there. Pile Driver, Chieftain, and then Rabble Master. And, you know, it shows why those cards are in the deck in multiples.
Absolutely, yeah. It's worth noting that if you're looking at our sideboard here, We don't have graveyard hate. There are some applications for Goblin Chain Whirler because they do play a number of X1s, Bloodghast and Narcomoeba. And I think because that has any amount of interaction with their deck, we should bring them in. I think these Legion War Bosses are probably the most clunky spells in our deck and not great in this matchup when there's, you know, things like Prize Amalgam on the board. And then I'll shave one of these Wily Goblins. All right.
All right, on the Dredge side, there's no need to use counter hate because, like Eric mentioned, there's a lack of hate. So really just supplementing what we're already doing with additional Dark Blast and Collective Brutality to maybe get some annoying creatures off the board. But mostly just looking to do the same thing we did game one and be a little bit faster and a little bit more efficient than the Goblins were.
Yeah, I'm going to keep this hand. I think it has a couple key cards. No one drop, but... you know, definitely some tools that we're looking for in the matchup, and potentially even the best card in the deck in multiples. It's a bit unfortunate that we haven't had a Lackey draw that we can play. Like, you know, we had a seven with a Lackey and a Goblin in it, but it was a bunch of lands on top of that, so not good enough.
Okay. Sorry about the delay. Let me get my game plan going. Let's see, this is going to need to be Blood Crypt. Yes, I'll pay two. And it'll be a Stitcher Supplier. So had you played a Goblin Lackey, I would be willing and able to block it, but I don't know how it played out.
All right. So let me pop out that graveyard again. Right now, it's a bunch of blanks. But you have to assume Matt has the ability to start dredging here somehow.
So Goblin Lackey, Goblin Power Driver, somewhat scary. We saw what happened last game. We saw how effective it can be. I don't yet have a dredger in my graveyard. Let's try to fix that problem with Stitcher Supplier. Golgari Thug. Okay, that qualifies. So now we can Faithless Looting for full value. So I could have Faithless Looting turn one and discarded Life from the Loam, but you end up with a lot more explosiveness if you can get the Dredger card in the graveyard first. Then you're benefiting from the first half of Faithless Looting and the second half. So here I get to dredge and dredge again. Narcomoeba is hit with an Amalgam in the graveyard, and we're discarding two of our dredgers along the way. Here comes Narcomoeba, there goes Amalgam, and we're done with our turn. If Pile Driver wants to get involved in combat, we'll be happy to block it with a Stitcher Supplier. So off to the races here, and Goblin deck has its back against the wall.
Yep, so I'm definitely a decent clock here from Matt's side. I have the option of two different things this turn. One, I can play Skirk Prospector and try and set up for a Collected Company next turn, or I can use all my mana this turn and play Goblin Chieftain. I think we're far enough behind right now that we need to make sure that we use our mana every turn. We can't fall behind too much, and I don't think Collected Company is going to be able to get us back in a game after Matt is able to flashback one of these Faithless Lootings next turn, which I think he's very likely to do given four cards in hand. So I'm just going to fetch for a mountain here and play a Goblin Chieftain. And we could attack here, and that would end up trading the Chieftain for the two Stitcher Supplier. But I think the benefits that we get off of the haste and the Lord effect from the Chieftain means that it's not worth the trade, especially because he's going to get to mill an additional six cards. So we get sort of a free attack here with the Pile Driver, but I'd rather keep it back on blocking duty for this Amalgam here.
Okay, so other side of the board, we're going to dredge our Sinkweed Imp. Nothing fancy. We hit a Creeping Chill. That'll help us be even more ahead in the race. We do have a decision point here regarding what to do with our main phase. I don't have a land for flashing back looting at this time. So I think it's just going to be life from the loam. 1, 2, 3. Pay green one. So at least I'll make sure I'm well equipped for next turn. That's going to be Copperline Gorge. I'm going to turtle up here because of this card, Conflagrate. So I'm going to Conflagrate with no targets this turn. Now that's set up for next turn, and things are going to be boding pretty well for me from there.
Okay. So we did hit the fourth land here to play Collected Company, but now there's a Conflagrate in the graveyard. So next turn, Matt is going to be able to dredge back life from the loam, cast it, and then go up to 8 cards in hand. He'll be able to play a land like the City of Brass going down to 7, and then he'll be able to conflagrate for 7, which is quite a bit. It's going to be probably tough to win through that, considering he'll be able to like hit our Lord and then pick off all of our other creatures. But we will have the ability to refuel after that with the second company in our hand. So I'm going to go ahead and pay the 2 life here, and then company into double pile driver, which is pretty strong. And I think we know, we're pretty much 100% that all of our creatures are going to die next turn. If you're able to conflagrate for 7, that's going to let one thing live, and I think it has to be a pile driver. But knowing that most of our stuff is dying anyway, I think we should be attacking here. And one of these pile drivers will get to connect.
Sounds reasonable. All right, so blue creatures can't block pile driver. It makes my decision tree fairly straightforward. We put the amalgam on this. We muster a couple chump blocks, and as Eric said, I don't have another block for another third pile driver, so I can't make one. And I certainly don't want to take extra damage, and I don't mind Scissor Suppliers dying. Yes, I will use Narcomoeba's ability. Okay, so I have a life from the loam to dredge. And Eric talked about this on his turn, but here it comes. We're gonna loam back any 3 lands will do. Sure. We now can conflagrate X equals 7. Alright, 2 to that pile driver. You get a pile driver. You get a pile. Now I'm going to pay red, red. This is the fun part. Discard your entire hand. 1 with nothing. Eat your heart out.
I mean, this card actually does something when you discard your entire hand, so it's definitely got the advantage there. All right. So we have no board. We're facing down 5 power. We're at 13 life.
Now, I'm at 9. I wonder what the worst thing that could happen to me. So I wonder if I ought to leave something back. So Warchief, Land, Rabblemaster. Warchief, Land, Rabblemaster would be... I mean...
Warchief, Land, Rabblemaster would be 7 damage, or 8 damage.
Yeah.
2 from the Warchief, 2 from the Rabblemaster, 1 from the token, and then 3 from the bonus. So, or is that 7? No, it's 8 total.
8. All right, well, I'm from the show me state. Not really, but I'll pretend like I'm from the show me state. I can't count that high, so attack with everything when in doubt.
All right, so we're at a virtual 6 because these Narcomoebas are almost certainly going to attack next turn. And given the fact that there's 21 cards in Matt's deck, it's very likely that, or there's a decent chance that he's going to hit what's the card? A
creeping chill.
That's right. So we should act like we're at a virtual three life, which means that we can't let the amalgam hit here. I actually think what we're going to do is just pass the turn and then obviously represent a collected company.
That sounds reasonable to me. I'm going to dredge Stinkweed Imp. I do hit one Creeping Chill, but not the two that would be necessary to close this thing out. So Eric wisely didn't go crazy on his turn. He's just going to play a little bit defensively. I've got now that I have a Stinkweed Imp to block, and Faith is looting to threaten to find the last Creeping Chill. So let me just attack with everybody, see what plays out.
Yeah, so what we're looking to hit off this collected company here is Goblin Chain Whirler.
Ooh, that would be nasty.
So we have quite a few options here. We didn't hit a Chain Whirler. I think that would be an obvious include, but we do have quite a few good options. So Matt's at 12 here. He has one card in hand. What did you dredge this turn?
I have a Stinkweed Imp in my hand.
Okay, so they're going to have one blocker. So Pile Driver is probably not what we want to take here, just because he's going to be able to invalidate it pretty effectively. So what I'm going to do is take Chieftain and Rabble Master. We'll put these on the bottom.
All right, well, that leaves me definitely thankful that I attack with everybody because it does force a block.
Yeah. So we do have to block like this, but we wanted to take something that would actually kill this amalgam.
So my choices here. I have one. No, let's see. I've got two Creeping Chills left in my deck that are lethal out of 16 cards. So so it's not really much of a choice. We're going to try to hit that. So Faithless Looting, and I'm going to dredge as much as I can. And I may hit a Narcomoeba that helps me chump block if I miss on the chill.
Okay.
I hit a chill and a Narcomoeba. Okay. So that's that.
Yeah. And I actually think we're having a pretty tight game. So in my hand, I have Legion Loyalist plus Goblin Rabble Master. That's a pretty big attack next turn. Plus the Loyalist trigger is going to help invalidate the Stinkweed Imp a little bit. But double chill here means we're dead. And a pretty quick 0-2 from this Goblins list.
Two really hard matchups. So the third one, I think, is more interesting. And it's also a tough matchup, though. So, all right, let's 0-2 so far. But we've got blue-white control coming up. So Path to Exile and Supreme Verdict won't make it easy. But at least it'll be a little bit easier than Narcomoeba Conflagrate.
Oh, yeah, for sure. All right, here we are for match three. Looks like I'm on the draw here. Matt is going to be playing blue-white control again. And yeah, I think this hand is a keep. It's got a couple key cards in it, as well as a way to gain back some card advantage against the blue-white deck. So we're definitely going to keep this.
I have the interesting combo of Scrytop, fetch land. Sometimes if I know I'm fetching, first of all, if you know you're fetching, it's good to Scrytop because your opponent kind of thinks that you know what you're going to draw, but it's not actually the case. But anyways, against Goblin Lackey, wow, that makes this game really interesting. So here I don't fetch because my top card is Opt, and I'm going to need that Opt in order to try to find a path. Condemn. Wow, Lackey might just put me in a body bag here. So Opt bottom. Pass the turn.
Yeah, it's worth noting that the way that this deck is built, it's not meant to be super explosive. Like, it's not playing, you know, Siege Gang Commander or Goblin Trashmaster, these sorts of things. It's looking to put, like, a little bit more expensive of a spell in play and just, or a little, like, something in the 2-3 range, and maximize collected company. So there's not going to be anything crazy here, but we are going to get to make some, we are going to get to get ahead on the mana front a little bit. So we'll put this in play. It's the most expensive thing in our hand. and then we can shock ourselves and play this Skirk Prospector. The Loyalish should have come in pre-combat, but I was just thinking about things like Path to Exile. I figured maybe you use this path a little bit more aggressively. Okay, what does that mean for us?
So Eric knows that my deck has 3 Supreme Verdict, 2 Detention Sphere, 1 Condemn, 4 Path, Snapcaster, Opt is something that's in play. So he's got some things to play around somewhat, but it's one of those things where you end up looking at this and going, well, do I gain anything by holding back? And my creature's about to get first strike and trample, so stuff like Snapcaster trade off with Lackey is no longer available. Pile Driver is going to grow. And to cap it all off, I have nothing yet. So a few warning signs should be going off in Eric's head if I don't have anything about what could be possible.
Yeah, and I'm actually going to choose not to put anything on the battlefield with Lackey this turn. I have to assume that he has a sweeper. I don't think Matt would keep a hand against even a random opponent that has no interaction in the first couple turns with creatures in the modern format. So I'm not going to put anything with this, and we'll just pass the turn here.
All right, so I get to strand.
And because we already have a lethal clock on the table, I think that's a reasonable decision.
That sounds right. I mean, you have to anticipate perhaps having to rebuild. If my plan's Cryptic Command, it doesn't matter that you have extra stuff out. So that all sounds pretty reasonable. That's the turn.
Yeah, so now this definitely reads like a Cryptic Command. So we're just going to go to attacks and see what happens.
So I'm aware that it's actually scary that my opponent can collect the company after a Cryptic. If they hit one of the lords that gives haste, I could be dead, I could be in trouble. But I don't have the luxury of playing around something like that since my opponent's already representing lethal, so it'll be tap draw. I don't recommend that Eric responds with the cocoa if he's got it.
Yeah, so I do have the collective company here, and I think I'm trying to see if there's any combinations of card in my deck that'll do exactly 7 here. And that would be, I think Chieftain plus Rabblemaster is exactly lethal.
So, well, no, because Rabblemaster token making opportunity is gone.
You're right.
And if you're going for sub lethal, it's pretty dangerous because my next play could be a sweeper, but maybe better just hold back Coco. And it's hard to imagine it's going to get worse than like end step Coco. Let's say you do have a lethal creatures, end step Coco accomplishes the same thing if I sweep.
Yeah, I think given what the rest of my hand is, I'm okay with you. Let's see, if we put a... Yeah, definitely an interesting tension here. I'm just going to choose to pass here.
Yeah, I mean, it feels right from afar. Again, I don't know what's in your hand, but that at least it makes sense from afar.
I do have some strong follow-ups, assuming that you have a Wrath this turn. And go to combat again. All right, this makes sense. I don't think we're going to change anything about our play.
This is sort of strange game, but sometimes these control matchups play out this way.
So I'm assuming there's going to be a third Cryptic here, but okay. So how Matt scries off this Serum Visions is probably going to inform what plays I make over the next over the next turn. All right, so you put one on bottom and one on top, and he does still have cryptic mana up. So what does that mean for us?
Eventually, I'm going to run out of cryptic commands.
Yeah, and he did miss a land drop for a few turns there. I'm guessing that the scry at the top was a land, which means that Snapcaster is going to be in play for the three cryptics in his yard next turn. And that one Snapcaster represents all three cryptic commands because he can Snapcaster and then bounce the Snapcaster and tap down with the tap down the team. Given what the rest of my hand is, I'm actually going to do this now.
I'm going to target that with Absorb, so I get a little bit of a life buffer.
Okay. So Matt's at 10 now, and the question is, that was an interesting draw too. Can we beat him through a Path to Exile this turn? I think we're close, but we're going to need to hit well. Let's try this out.
Okay, well, I can't do anything about that.
All right, so we have quite a few options here. Let's see. So Matt's at 10. We have right now on the table 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10. 6, 7, 8, 9. Yeah, we have 10 on. We pretty much have Lethal on the table right now. I'm not 100% sure it matters what we take here, but that seems reasonable along with that.
Okay, and so from my perspective, I have a path which can stop both the Chieftain and the new pile driver, but then if you look at what's still coming in, it's the 10, so it's kind of, it's an exact math type of situation, but it's not math that's favorable for me. Nothing I could have done there. My draw, I was relying on a mana leak to slow Eric down, and Goblin Lackey, actually, this is the first game where we got to see the strength of a turn one Lackey, because it's the first game where Eric's had turn one Lackey, yeah. and it really shows off the power of that card, but in a fun and still interactive way.
And Pile Driver did good work that game. So I was okay with getting past there as well, just because I had War Chief into a couple Goblins follow-up, so I would have had a strong turn regardless. All right. Sideboarding. I think Legion Loyalist is probably the worst goblin in our deck, because that's really for matchups where the opponent is going to be doing blocking, which the blue-white control deck doesn't really do. And then Shaper's Sanctuary is going to help us combat the paths and condemns a little bit. So we'll bring those in, and we'll take those Loyalists out. And I think that's everything that we're going to want to do in this matchup.
All right, I've got to decide now to make one more cut. I guess this card costs 100 mana. That's probably not what I want to be doing. All right. It doesn't cost literally 100. That probably wouldn't make the cut on the deck, but functionally 100.
It sounds like Teferi.
Something like that. All right, keep that.
All right, I think this is probably the most important card in the matchup, and we have it in our hand, and I'm going to keep as a result. I think this hand is probably on the edge of what's keepable and what's not. It's worth noting that we do have, I believe it's 10 green producing lands plus 3 Wily Goblins, so we have about 13 outs to be able to take cast the company by turn 4 here. Okay. Into 2 mana, I don't want to just run this out. I don't think that's worth the potential of 2-for-1-ing myself. So we're just going to play land and attack here.
So a little sub-lesson for the viewers there. I had, I'm planning on opting, and it's all I have. And I played an untapped land, not because like I'm going to path. I don't expect to have to do that, and I'd have to hit it off opt. But rather, instead of playing Hollowed Fountain and kind of using my mana most efficiently, Skrook Prospector really, you don't really want to tap out against that for no reason. So anyways, long story short, I'd rather have two mana untapped, make it look like I've got a little more interaction than I do. And I'll find a way to have another window for the Hallowed Fountain, such as this one. And so I just kind of, it's just when you're playing control, you want to be a little bit tricky with what you can do, what you can't do. Your deck has the benefit of playing most of its strategy in the hidden field of the hand. Go ahead and take advantage of it. And that's how I approach that turn too. But anyways.
Yeah, and take my turns like that and trying to figure out what the best play is versus what all the possible cards in their hand are is one of the things I think is actually fun about playing against control. So, you know, decisions like that, especially when you're playing a creature deck like this, are interesting. So we're not doing a good job at using our mana here, but we're just going to continue to attack with this Skirk Prospector and see if we can get Matt to use his mana for anything. It'd be nice if we had more of a clock on a table. Like, you can imagine that if we had Prospector into a Pile Driver onto this, would probably be, you know, definitely a different game. Okay, that's a good draw. All right, so that's gonna change things now.
Okay, so an uncounterable Rabble Father. Yeah, that's a cool one. It's gonna draw this Path to Exile. This blue-white deck is long on ways to go kind of one for one, and then it's got sweepers that try to pull ahead. So going slow and going kind of one card at a time is not as bad as it sometimes looks or feels. Just because, and after sideboard, you get some Baneslayer Angel type stuff that helps change that dynamic. But, you know, just kind of a nod towards how Eric is approaching this game where, yeah, not a lot's happening, but, you know, outside of Cryptic Command and a few sweepers, like, the sweepers only become 3-for-1s when you overcommit, so it's interesting.
Yeah, and, you know, just so we can have a conversation about it, I have two Collected Company in my hand, and I feel like that's the card that's going to allow me to actually win over time, just because it'll allow me to get ahead on cards, and running them into a counterspell like a Cryptic Command is just not a winning game plan for my end.
Right.
All right, so he has the ability to activate the Colonnade and block here, but if he wants to spend his mana that way just to eat this Prospector, that's fine by me. The other thing is it taps him low, and it's going to allow us to potentially resolve one of the companies, so that puts us in an okay spot. All right. Now I think it's time for this.
Okay, so I'm gonna do this, and now
dispel. Yikes.
So, okay. Yeah, I could have found a different way of, like, managing my way through that Collected Company, but the problem, you don't want to sandbag Dispel against a creature deck that has a few instants. I mean, you really want to, I think, try to get that out of the way. But on the other hand, it would have been more mana efficient try to use that on a later company. I just don't want to rely on my opponent, especially with Cavern out now. I can't really hope that my cards line up well. I got to try to just get that Dispel out of the way. All right, see if I can just take 20 from that Skrook Prospector then.
We are getting a little bit fluttered here. It's worth noting that we actually have more lands out than the control deck, but that's part of Magic. Snapcaster here is a little bit rough, but yeah, Dispel is looking great here. All right, let's try it again.
Yeah, that one lands. Let's see how bad it is.
Not the greatest hits, but that's all we had available, so we'll take it.
So yeah, it's pretty important that I get this prospect off the table. The three companies in the yard, less important. Before those companies, it's kind of annoying when you're playing against a deck with Prospector and you're trying to, you know, let's say Wrath them or whatever, or settle the record, whatever you're trying to do with some sweeper, because they can cash out their goblins for mana and then Coco after your sweeper. So anyways, nice to have that guy off the board, just to kind of a little bit more relaxed feeling.
Mm-hmm. And because you didn't save the Snapcaster to block the Rabble Master next turn, I'm assuming that you have a sweeper to follow up this turn and you were just gaining some life. So I'm not going to commit anything else to the board here, and I'm just going to pass back. Although...
It would seem kind of crazy to commit more than this right now. I think
it's a good clock as it is.
It's good enough, and you just don't want to lose on the spot to one of the many sweepers that are present, or certainly possible here. So yeah, it's gonna be all right. So didn't draw the land I was hoping for.
Yeah, there's the sweeper. Okay,
I'll have to approach it this way.
All right, so now definitely showing one of the, I would call it, weaknesses of Goblin Lackey. It's a pretty bad top deck in spots like this. But, you know, Matt's tapped out right now, and I don't really think that any of these cards are in our hand are going to get much better this game. So we're going to run out some little green men here. Saving the cavern for the Wily Goblin, because that's probably the best out of the bunch that we had in our hand.
It's a depressing state of affairs, huh?
Absolutely, yeah.
All right, so I wouldn't say that the blue-white deck has turned the corner in the sense of, you know, I have Colonnade, but I don't really have a firm grasp on the game, but with five cards in hand and a missed land drop last turn, I mean, the writing's on the wall here.
Yeah, definitely. I think maybe give it another draw step or two and then probably pack it in after that. Like, I'm not going to be able to... Yeah, this Glimmer is just going to find more gas, and I don't have anything like a Shaper Sanctuary going.
Yeah, I have it all. I've got Snapcaster, Cryptic, Settle the Wreckage, Logic Knot. Yeah. I mean, you can go ahead and... We can go on to game three.
Yeah, I think so.
Whenever you're ready.
Yeah. Okay. So definitely a weak draw from the Goblins deck that game, but, you know, we flooded out quite a bit. Two pile drivers on top of the deck might have made a difference, but probably not in the face of a bunch of Cryptic Commands. All right. I don't think I want to change anything about how we sideboarded, so let's go to game three here.
Yeah, and Dispel was so strong that game that... I think it's a little bit counterintuitive. I think I actually am in the market for one negate and one dispel. There's dead card risk, but the card I'm taking out is Teferi, the last Teferi in my deck, and that bears almost as much dead card risk, because when Goblins beats you, I mean, five mana, kill one creature, you know, five mana, tuck one creature doesn't really get you out. So I'm going to go ahead. I think that negate gives me better counterplay than Teferi gives me active play.
Yeah, the dispel was pretty backbreaking that game. All right, well, this is definitely a keep from us. We have a super important card in the matchup and a nice little curve here. It's worth noting, tiny little edge. I probably could have led on like a basic mountain there to play the Skirk Prospector. You know, Matt does have a few cantrips in his deck, and leading on Cavern lets him know that his counter magic is going to be a little bit less effective this game. So maybe saving this until turn two or three, when that counter magic is turned on, could be better. So, like, you know, if he plays a Serum Visions here and sees like a mana leak on top of his deck, maybe he's less likely to keep that now that there's a Cavern of Souls in play.
Fair point.
All right, we'll just go to attacks here.
All right, I'll do what I do best. Take one Stroke Prospector.
Let's see if we can do all 20 this game. All right, I'll follow it up with this guy. We'll pass.
Yeah, that's going to be pretty powerful. It's going to send me to the bottom with that. Draw. Okay, so now the... Yeah, it's interesting. Like, this is a pretty... A tension in this matchup that feels no different than really what it feels like to play blue-white control against, let's say, a Humans or a... or a Spirits deck. Now, those decks are a little bit better at putting some, like, Melee Mage on the board to stop what you're trying to do, but they're kind of dangerous in a similar way. If you don't have anything that interacts, you can find yourself dead.
Yeah, and it's worth noting that, you know, those decks, I think, are really strong in Modern because they're a quick clock plus disruption, and this deck really is just nothing but a quick clock. Just the Ambush Viper here. Okay.
Oh, I forgot Pro Blue is going to stop me here. Now, I actually, as it turns out, I didn't have a better play because my only other things I can do are counter spells, which are not effective against Cavern of Souls. So I think upon reflection, I would still end up on Snapcaster. But when I cast it, I was hoping to block Power Drive. Then I was like, wait a minute, that doesn't work. Instead, I'm going to have to find a different approach. So that's going to, yeah, and just again, I mean, Cavern just lines up nicely against my mana leak type of strategy. So it's going to be
Detention Spear,
Ravel Master, and just try to stem a little bit. So that's where we are. And you can see why that, stopping that Stroke Prospector, it's already 3 damage, plus you don't know what that card is going to do in terms of making mana. So the Ambush Viper there, still a fine 1-for-1 that I'm not happy to make, but in this case... It's a clear block.
Yeah, and I think that even that life point is going to matter here. I have 4 on the table right now, and the question is, do I want to commit more onto the board into a Wrath? I think right now the answer is probably no. But if you Wrath, I have some fine follow-ups, so... As always, that tension between Supreme Verdict and Cryptic Command is sort of what's governing my play this game. But, that's what playing against blue-white control is about. All right, so no Wrath here. Pretty likely a Cryptic Command. Let's move to attacks and see what happens.
So, I am going to need to tap all opposing creatures and purchase one additional card.
It's a good rate.
Yeah, I got kind of back-footed this game, and it's not over yet, but it feels a little bit...
So Matt has 5 cards in hand. Both of these in our hand represent lethal. I think what I'm going to do is commit one more of them to the board, just to make them have it in terms of having an additional Cryptic Command. And then we have follow-ups, which is fine. Okay, so there it is.
Yeah, and, you know, from the blue-white, from this side of the matchup, I mean, anytime you're doing that and the opponent has less than 4 mana available, it feels pretty good. But, you know, things can certainly go wrong for you in this matchup. You know, just, yeah, something like this. And
yeah, a little army.
Doesn't take much.
A little army in a can. So the clock that we're presenting is 1 short of lethal, so Matt doesn't need to have an answer this turn, but it looks like he does anyway.
No, I think you had 6.
I think
you make another token and mentor once.
That's right, it is exactly 6, excuse me. Yeah. Oh, let's just say I use the cavern on that.
Yeah, I don't have an actual mentor. You've got something So, no worries there. All right, so yeah, Armina can, followed by Armina can. It means that I still have to have something else, despite having Wrath two turns in a row. So I'm going to need to make it three turns in a row.
Okay. That's tough for me.
So let's see if I cash Field of Ruin. I get to do that instead of that. No, that's not better. The Supremes.
Okay, well, we hit the best draw on our deck, so I think actually let's do this. Just do a little bit of deck thinning first. And if he has Dispel or Negate, that's going to be real good here.
Well, so I mentioned that one Negate that came in during sideboarding. Here it is.
Yeah, it's pretty strong.
That's the bad news. The good news is it's not like I have everything all together, so let's try Opto. Maybe I can get like a Baneslayer and we can wrap this up. Nope, not yet.
Yeah, that Opto goes to the bottom, which is a good sign for me, but you know, I think pretty much any Planeswalker is going to do it here, but I can probably beat some Colonnade attacks here. Yikes. Yeah, not looking like a great top deck.
Yeah, man, it looks like alright, I didn't hit a tremendously great card, but something now. I'm at 5, and Eric is, I guess I gotta think a little harder about this. So with me at 5, I'm trading 4 for 1, but if a Chieftain comes out, then I go to 1. I think I want to take a turn off and get or that's what it feels like to me.
Interesting. Okay, well, we're going to play that here. I think it's not very likely to be relevant, but
never a creature you control becomes target.
Yeah, so it doesn't interact with the Field of Ruin, but you know, Matt's already used 3 Supreme Verdicts this game, which means that he's almost guaranteed to need a Snapcaster to find another one, and that means that if he wants to do any interacting with our creatures for the rest of the game, it's probably going to be through Path to Exile. Effects like that. I'm not going to attack into the Colonnade here.
It does have a force in the deck.
Yeah, that's the force is the reason why I didn't fetch a second stomping ground earlier.
That makes sense to me. Now that Cavern's off the board, I'm a little bit less. Let's get this out. I'm 1 mana off of being able to attack and block. I'm 2 mana off from being attacked with both. Skirky. Yeah.
So, no. No blocking here. I probably could have held that in hand because I guess it's free to put it in play off the Lackey, but we're talking about things that, you know, it doesn't really matter here. Glimmer of Genius, okay. Still has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 available, which means you're still going to get the Colonnade attack in this turn. You know, let's see. You went Scry top-bottom. Okay. Yeah, and I can pack it in after that. I'll give it a draw step and see what it is, but I don't have any ways to really deal with something like that. Yep, that's gonna do it.
All right, quick 0-3. We'll get the switch to a better deck builder and player.
Yeah,
giving you a hard time. We put a slate together for the Lackey deck here that was a pretty brutal gauntlet. It hung in there against blue white certainly, but ultimately a little bit too strong on all three matchups.
Yeah, and I think there were some problems with the way the deck was built, but I think we can get into that in sort of the post-mortem after we play three of your matches as well.
Sounds good. All right. Eric, let's get into the deck tech here for this version of Goblin Lackey, which is the one that I came up with. It's a little bit, it's just to contrast it with your version first, you'll notice that it's mono red. You'll notice that the curve goes all the way up to 5, and it goes heavy with 4 Siege Gang Commander. So different attempt here. Collected Company doesn't make an appearance, but what does is Warren Instigator, the modern version of Goblin Lackey that was always kind of hanging around. And my thinking is that by playing, and you know, first of all, Simeon Spirit Guide in that buried in those 3s is actually a 0. Simeon Spirit Guide, kind of like a Lotus Petal here. It's going to let me turn Warren Instigator into a more potent turn 1 Lackey. That's going to combine, hopefully, to give me some redundancy with Lackey. And then that'll allow me to get away with 4 Siege Gang Commanders. At least that's the theory. The idea here also is just that gold fishing with 2 Goblin Grenade and a bunch of ways to deal damage quickly, Lackeying and Warren Instigatoring into these Siege Gangs and the like. Lightning Bolt and Goblin Grenade can also get the Lackey and Instigator through should the opponent put up, let's say, a 2-2 defender. So anyways, long story short, we got a slightly more streamlined, lower land count, higher explosiveness version. And, you know, it may fold to a deck that has Lightning Bolts and Snapcasters. Wouldn't surprise me. But at the same time, you know, maybe Siege Gang Commander becomes a way to try to, you know, sneak in something really robust against those decks that doesn't just die to Lightning Bolt. So we'll have to see how it plays out.
Yeah, I'm excited to see this version work. It's definitely a little bit more on the all-in side, which I think is might where you want to be in Modern. There is a decent amount of interaction in Modern, but there's a lot of people who are trying to ignore what their opponent is doing as much as possible. And, you know, this deck is going to be able to present a pretty quick clock. So I think we're going to see some explosive quick kills out of this.
And if it's nothing else, it should be fun.
Oh, yeah. Goblin Grenade is a fun card for you.
All right, let's get down to the matches. All right, now it's my turn. Welcome to our fourth matchup. This time it's the mono red Lackey Siege Gang Commander deck against a mono red deck. I have a pretty interesting hand here. So it is the rare No Land Keep.
The No Land Keep. Okay. Well, we went down to 6. I think we have a...
I lost your audio there for a second, but I'm back now, hopefully. Swiss Spear is going to connect for 1. Yeah, okay, so this is good. I can play a Lackey, and then hopefully my opponent's plan here is to block, and if it is, then...
Yeah, I'm actually having trouble hearing you here. It seems like you're breaking up because of... I think your audio is dropping quite a bit. Can you...
All right, so... We lost. I'm having a little bit of audio trouble here with Eric, so I'm going to go. Solo commentary here, so bear with me, and we may edit this piece out. I'm not sure, but I'm going to jump back into the match in a moment, and I'm just going to do solo commentary here. So apologies for the technical issues, but we're going to have video and audio for you. It's just going to be only me. All right, so Lava Spike, Swift Spear. Now, if he bolts the Lackey, then I guess in response, light up the stage. Okay. So I'm going to exile this and bolt down the Swift Spear. If has Gutshot, I'm in trouble. But no Gutshot, then I should be kind of golden here. With Lackey connecting, light the stage. It's going to help him later, but not now, since he already played a land. All right. So this should be interesting. Name Nilbog, a.k.a. Goblin. Goblin King could be a big card at some point. All right, this is exciting. First game, and we're getting to see Lackey just do its thing right away. Siege Gang Commander is now on the board. And that's going to be trouble for my opponent, that is. Lightning Bolt could, let's say, take out the Siege Gang Commander, but, you know, once this Goblin King comes out, then we're good. Yeah, I don't like this play, because Lightning Bolt should be used first, to, otherwise I can just sack whatever he bolts and kill that Goblin Guide. So, perhaps some poor sequencing from Eric. Yeah, I wonder if it's better testing to go upstairs here, because that was a pretty poor play, but, you know, I didn't show up to go easy on anybody, so let me go ahead and Siege Gang that Goblin Guide. Yeah, I'll sack it to its own ability. So, yeah, for the purity of testing, again, I mean, I just think he sequenced those cards poorly, but, yeah, I don't know, maybe he was baiting me, maybe he wants the life, I don't know, but also I might make a mistake and there's no way to correct those, so better just go hard than try to do some weird correction. Alright, I did not hit what I had hoped to hit, obviously a land for Goblin King and just kind of smash for 8. I can get 3 damage in by sacking my Lackey, not really in love with that play. Have a lot going on for me right now. There's no need to really go nuts. So it's just going to be Metallic Mimic, a card that ought to come in handy should I ever draw a third land or get to connect with the Lackey. Eric is only at a 2-card hand. Feels like I'm really in the driver's seat here. Famous last words. Nope. Okay. So I've got multiple ways to kind of put him in a body bag. This is definitely the most fun. To try to Goblin King, get the Lackey in, counter on that, drop a second Siege Gang. Hopefully I return on no scooping because I want you guys to be able to see what's about to happen to him. Right click, attack with everything. Metallic Mimic makes the King a 3-3. I mean, were it to get bolted, I mean, things would kind of perhaps go south. But obviously, I'm going to go for this kill because my opponent doesn't look like a bolt. It doesn't look like a bolt is in my future. So, you know, you kind of get a read at some point that there's not a bolt hanging around. All right, if he wins this game, I'm going to throw this deck in the garbage can. All right, he's seen enough. Well, that was pretty sweet. All right, well, we got these Dragon Claws for a reason. Goblin King Mountain Walk for a reason. Chain Whirler, not quite. Certainly Blood Moon, no. So Simeon Spirit Guide's interesting. There's a question here. I don't think I want to 2-4 myself against. I expect him to be able to kill what I'm doing, like to destroy what I put out there a little bit more frequently in a post-board game. I mean, Goblin Grenade kind of operates the same way, but then it lets me win a race. So I'm just going to do without the Spirit Guides, I believe. Go Land Light, because the game goes a little bit longer. I mean, the Spirit Guide was good that game. It's not a perfect strategy. I just don't want to, like, be in a spot where I'm pitching Spirit Guide to get the Chieftain out there, only to get it bolted, and find myself down 2 cards. So we'll try it this way and hope that Dragon's Claw can be one of the things that drags a game out to where I can actually draw a third land. We had a snap keep from Eric. Huh. Do I try to play control? Just play goblin control? Yeah, I mean, mulling to six doesn't sound great, so I'll try to play goblin control. It may not work, but all right, that's a good start. It gives me something to, something to control. It's pretty ideal. Alright, four of a kind. It's pretty hard to get four of a kind in a 8-card stud, but we did it. Already kind of feeling the pinch of choosing to play these goblin grenades over the spirit guy, but obviously it, when you draw one land, that's how you're going to feel. What we don't want to see is an Arclight Phoenix hit the graveyard, and we dodged. Alright, goblin control. Go ahead. 7 cards in hand of your 4. Do your worst. You'll notice my mountains are a lot prettier than Eric's. Just something to keep track of at home. Light up the stage. Powerful card there. Manamorphose and Arclight Phoenix. Alright, so we dodged in the sense that no land came out. And Arclight Phoenix is not going to be easy to cast from exile. I'm not going to go upstairs again, just reiterating that it feels like I'm in a control seat. Now my choices are discard versus Bolt Your Face, and I still believe that I want to find myself in a control role here. I'm just going to discard Goblin Grenade, and I feel like the games where the Goblin Grenade was going to matter are going to be the games that I win. And the tapping out of Bolt just doesn't feel right to me. Opponent could easily play Monastery Swift Spear or stick a Arclight Phoenix out with this Faithless Looting or, you know, Manamorphose coming in. So I'd rather have Bolt up than avoid discarding card. You don't want to get into a mindset with a deck, with any deck. You don't want to get into a mindset where it's like, well, I don't want to, discarding cards is bad, therefore I won't do it. You know, you want to be thoughtful about stuff like that. Soulscar Mage, Faithless Looting. So I bolt now, unless... No, I can't bolt now because I don't think he's going to have a... it could be mana. Plays a land and now I can't bolt it. Yeah, I'll bolt it. I'll take my chances with Phoenix, I guess. And then I can take 3 and bolt it next turn. And I guess there could be a gut shot here. Should have just bolted in response to the trigger, huh? Alright, got lucky. Now, if no Phoenix gets discarded, then I got really lucky, or my luck continues. We know this Arclight Phoenix off of the Light Up the Stage is doomed to not return. And yeah, there's no other Phoenix, so. Not the greatest draws from Eric, but he did find another land. Okay, I feel good here. I feel better when a land shows up. I'm only playing 18. So this is going to happen. This is definitely going to happen from time to time. There's a Dragon's Claw. There we go. Now we're cooking with gas. Goblin. There's two schools of thought here. One, he's only got one card in hand. How does he not kill a card like Metallic Mimic? So don't I want to save my Warren Instigator? Second school of thought, if he doesn't kill Warren Instigator, I'm going to win by putting in 2 Rabble Masters. And if he does kill it, then he has to beat the other cards. And this card has kind of a decaying relevance. So I'm going to, these are all heuristics, but the heuristic I'm going to follow is this card is a must kill, but it has a decaying value. It's not going to be, if it's the last card you play, it's not great. Whereas the Mimic, I feel like it decays a little bit. But if I get to the next turn and go Mimic, if he doesn't have removal, let's say, I'm just going to win. So if he does have removal, then great, I get to play Mimic, and now I'm on a slightly different plan that's really powerful too. So I choose a lead with the Warning Skitter. Yeah, like this Arclight Phoenix, I think, is just going to get completely outclassed immediately and significantly. We'll see if that's how it pans out. Yeah, no attack. But the land means I can just bolt it down. Whoops, don't tap like that. That would be a big mistake. Okay. This is where things are going to get fun. Things are about to get fun once again. Now it's still playing Goblin Control. Going to give another life with the Dragon's Claw. Couldn't care less about that because things are about to get really hairy for him. Now I'm having fun. Rabble Master, that's 3-3. Rabble Master, that's 3-3. And when I play the second Mimic, these tokens will be 3-3s. Yeah, this is just... Now, if he plays, like... If he has a, you know, a sweeper from the sideboard off the top of the deck, then, you know, I'll tip my cap. If he doesn't, he's probably just going to die on the spot. Pay this loot and gain a life. Pretty hard for him to put together three spells to get this Ugly Phoenix back. Wow. There it is. So, we saw really, I mean... the deck in a couple different modes. In, you know, Goblin Lackey gets through and I just sneak in with a Siege Gang Commander, and the other one was just like, hey, I'm playing Bolts and I'm gonna run you out of stuff. So that was fun. That was quite fun. All right, next one, next matchup will be a little different. Play against Tron. So let's see how that one goes. All right, welcome everybody to another round of Mono Red Lackey Siege Gang all-in version. I'm playing against Tron this round. I've got the most important card, Goblin Lackey. So I've got, you know, a plate, steak knife, steak sauce. Don't yet have the steak in terms of a goblin to actually put in. But there's enough going on here. It doesn't take much. And I've only got 18 lands in my deck, 15 remaining after these three are out. Not going to take much to turn this into an explosive draw, so I'm going to keep it. Opponent also mulligans, makes them... less explosive on average. Chromatic Star. Let's see. Alright. No surprises yet. Spirit Guide. So I could drop two lackeys for laughs. And I need to at least consider that. I don't want to play one lackey and then think, because then it'll reveal that I have a spirit guide. So I mean, that sounds good to me. I don't know, I'm just gonna do it. The ways that could backfire is, you know, next round I might want to have a lord in play while the lackey is attacking, but actually that's a break even on damage, so this just seems right. Still kind of, but this, my draw, I mean, this next draw step is huge. Should I draw any goblin that costs more than one, I think I'll be happy. And anything else, I think I'll be not happy. Really insightful there, but... Okay, opponent only managed to put a second copy of the same piece out. That's important, because that really slows down... Oh, and dismember. Interesting, so... The fact that I put two lackeys in play, not super relevant here, but opponent played four life just to get one damage off the board. I only have one goblin, so that worked out for us. And we'd rather have this Warren Instigator survive. So, all right, it's going okay. I did draw a goblin that cost more than one. Not the perfect goblin, but not the worst one either. I have 8 points of burn in hand, so certainly like the double strike matters. And if I draw a lord, it's going to... Yep, and there's the lord. All right. So right on command. Now it starts to be like where cards like Karn aren't enough. So done with that Warren Instigator trigger. Done with those triggers. Opponent's at 7. I've got 8 points of burn. Wormcoil is no good. Ugin is good because Ugin can wipe my board, but it seems like a temporary fix, not a permanent one. So feeling pretty good. Goblin Lackey doing its thing. Warren Instigator getting into the mix. Yeah, that's not close to enough. So, why wait? I guess I should have sacked the one that this one makes him play around the second grenade, but it's... as soon as he targets one, I can just bolt him, and then he'll know to pack up. I could have sacked a different creature and then avoided him thinking he had to play tight. Alright, that's all she wrote. Good stuff. Sideboard against Tron. one of the few matchups where... So I'm getting a much easier slate of matchups than what we gave Eric. I mean, we're going to end up concluding, well, one of the deck worked pretty well, the other one didn't. In reality, I mean, the matchups, like, look, I've got a good matchup game. I mean, a decent matchup game one, a great sideboard card. So this is... Let's not draw any extreme conclusions about how the different decks are faring, but it's nice to see this deck in a lane where it thrives. Bolts don't seem like the type of thing that are going to be where I want to be. Trashmaster, in case one of those Wormcoil Engine type of cards shows up, I think I'm fine with that, as opposed to like a Goblin. Oh, the Blood Moon, eh. Actually, I'm kind of... It's interesting. Blood Moon with Goblin King, it's interesting enough, although, so I'm not sure exactly what I'm supposed to be doing. Metallic Mimic and Mog War Marshal. I definitely want stuff like Simeon Spirit Guide. It's probably something like Legion War Boss can go. Alright, I like my chances in this matchup. This is looking to be good enough. Again, my opponent's mulliganed. Doesn't hurt. CG and Commander are really a really excellent draw. Obviously, this Lackey is pretty likely to connect. If it doesn't, Warren Instigator is likely to connect. And Pile Driver, which I can cast if the Lackey does connect, is really going to... I mean, the opponent's really going to have the screws put to him quickly here. Double Goblin Grenade, I mean, it's nice. I only have to deal 10, and then it's just... That's all she wrote. So, everything coming up Sperling so far. Alright, let's see if Dismember is in the mix. No. I'll go with Siege Gang this time. Is there a sense in which I need to play around a sweeper? It'd have to be like Chromatic Star, Pyroclasm or something. We didn't come here to play around stuff. We came here to attack with goblins. That's what we're gonna do. Tron Land, Karn, I think I can beat that. Well, yeah, we're gonna find out. I wonder if, now, interestingly, this is really getting his Wormcoil Engine, because whatever he blocks gets sacked. Oh, wow. We're going to find out. Yeah, he's dead, I think. Well, let's see. Definitely drop that. Huh. Got to think for a second. So, you block the Pile Driver, you take 2 when I sack it. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, puts you at 11. And then I can, that's not very good. But it does... Rabble Master attack. The Pile Driver is going to trade off with the Worm Coil, certainly. It takes 4, 5, 6, 7. So he net takes 1. That doesn't seem good enough. Double Grenade the Worm Coil seems awful. Yeah, I think I need to go... There's also attack with everything. Let this trade, then grenade the lifelink. This is tough. I get the Rabble Master in play. I think it's just attack with everything. It's the Lion. I'm going to lose to like something like an Ugin or whatever. I can't play around everything. There's no way to not lose to Ugin, I don't think. Unless I'm supposed to let these guys trade. That's the only question. He breaks even on life. I'm still only losing to a sweeper? No, because then this is gone. Take the Worm Coil off the board, and then Goblin Grenade, the lifelink token. Kind of go slow to go fast. Go upstairs? No. Because I want him to like some find a way to not attack, and then I can grenade it. I don't think I want to just start letting him know that the burn is in play and induce him to attack or something. This is an interesting game. It's not clear to me. It's going to depend a lot on what's in Eric's hand. My draw was really explosive, but turn three, so is turn three natural Worm Coil, so... The fact that it's this competitive shows you the power of the Lackey at a siege gang. This is fun. You always like when your opponent untaps with Tron and then goes into a think. I mean, at least I always do, because a lot of times the worst thing that could happen to you is obvious. Let's say he had Tower, Ulamog, or Ugin or something. That tends to not take too long to find, so I'm glad that this is tank attack with Worm Coil. I can live with that. Thrag Tusk, maybe? Yeah. The Thrag Father, okay. Interesting. Huh. Yeah, so now we get to not have to sack, because this isn't a lifelink, and then we'll be able to sack on defense. So now we're in a pretty commanding position, I think. Let's get this in there. Because the Rabble Master, I assume he needs to block Rabble Master. I guess he doesn't. Oh, he doesn't know about Goblin Grenades. Oh, ooh. 8, 9. Yeah, this looks like a line that's going to lose to double grenade. Oh, it could be Dismember. No, even with Dismember. 4, 5. No, Dismember might be good enough. Wow, so Eric doing the math here hopefully puts himself in a spot where the double grenade... I only have 2 grenades in my list, so he knows my list, so it's not likely that he's going to get grenaded for 10. He's got to do some quick math here. Okay, does he die to sack the siege gang grenade? That's 7, 15, 16, 17, 19, 20. He doesn't. He can live through one grenade. So yeah, he's going to block this way. I'm going to say, okay, he's going to go to 9. I'm going to get another siege gang. I'm going to grenade him. This is insane. Everything's coming together. Beat turn 3 Worm Coil, no problem. Woo! Now we're having fun. Stay tuned. Last match coming up. We'll see if I can 3-0. All right. Here for round 6, we've got Goblin Lackey against The Rock. Gonna play a little control. We've fared pretty well so far against the combo and aggressive strategies. Let's see if we can get turn 1 Lackey. It's always what we're looking for. Alright, so yeah, I'm not gonna be mulliganing a hand like this against a Thoughtseize removal style deck. Mog War Marshal seems fine against them, and mulliganing seems not fine. So nothing flashy here with Lackey, but still, some fun cards to play. And some redundancy helps. Let's say his hand is weak to Rabble Master. If he has a Thoughtseize or an Inquisition, it's not going to be able to take both.
But it would be able to strip my 2-drop, so looking to draw something like a Lackey or another 2-drop. It's nice to have Army and a Can type of threats in Rabblemaster. They need to be dealt with immediately at instant speed, or you might be able to get value. Alright, so my draw is not something I can play. Obviously, with the aggressive deck, you're not looking to do nothing in the first 2 turns. However, you're always going to kind of end up in a grind against the black-green style deck. So just have to kind of hope that something like Tarmogoyf doesn't show up, or even in this spot, Scavenging Ooze is pretty rough. So yeah, not looking great. All right, Thought Seize is actually on balance. I mean, that's kind of what I'm hoping to see, as opposed to one of those fairly deadly 2-drops. Yeah, and Forest is not going to be threatening a second play, I don't think. Rabblefather. Alright, I must attack with it then. In that case, I will. Some powerful goblins in Modern. So the deck, you don't feel like you're playing a lot of poor cards. I think even stuff like Goblin Grenade and Goblin Chieftain, some of the more linear choices, I mean, they're pretty good cards. Nothing really wrong with a Lord that's this good or with a Goblin Grenade. So, you know, the games you don't draw Lackey, if your hand's clogged with Siege Game Commanders, it's going to feel pretty rough. But if it's just these other very reasonable cards, then you're not too upset. And that's a good sign for a deck like this. Collective Brutality with no kicker. Was there a kicker? Yeah, I got drained for 2 there along the way. Okay. I don't anticipate counter spells, but this is what I matter. Alright. So once this other Rabblemaster dies, I'm left with kind of hoping to draw Siege Game Commander, I guess. Flooded out a little bit. He still is put to the test here to answer the Rabblemaster, or it's going to continue to be pretty annoying. If you play something like Kalidus, then dynamic changes. Yeah, there it is. Yeah, that's not what I'm looking for. So clearly I'm going to send the Rabblemaster 2, and I'd love to trade. I don't think it'll happen. And at least it's a 4-point net breakthrough here. 7 comes through, 3 gets gained. If he does block Rabblemaster, it probably signals second Kalita, so that wouldn't be good. Kalita's a pretty powerful card. Let's say he's on air. Who's favorite this game? I still give edge to the Kalidus and 7 lands if his hand's 3 land. Or, you know, Inquisitions and Thought Seizes or whatever. Well, alright, so far so good. But, you know, in that context, things, you know, it wouldn't take much to swing it. Let's say he ends up going, you know, Field of Ruin, your Cavern. I shouldn't have played Cavern because it lets him Field of Ruin. That was bad, but live and learn. And then, yeah, something like Scavenging Ooze, I think that's enough to just seal this thing up. But, you know, Siege Game Commander, I suppose, has a chance of doing something. It's going to have to be Siege Game Commander relatively quickly. I wonder what, like, a Lord would do. Not enough. Oh, that certainly isn't it. So I still must attack with all my goblins. And at this point, do I trade for the Scavenging Ooze and give him a zombie with Kalidus? Probably not. Yikes. Yeah, well, things went from bad to worse. Not surprising. drew about 100 lands too many, but, you know, playing an 18 land deck, not going to happen super often, but it's not like I have anything to smooth my draws. On the sideboard, it's a matchup where you got to try to figure out, is it ever worth trying to Blood Moon somebody with that many basics? Maybe, I mean, but it might keep them off of something like a Kalidus, or you might catch them with a few more non-basics than basics that particular game. It seems kind of bad. I don't think I'm going to have a lot of tools out of the sideboard. All right, we can almost quit, but I guess I got to hang around because you never know if Siege Gang shows up, what could happen. Alright, so Eric's turned the corner. He's not interested in waiting around for Siege Gang to show up. Just what the doctor ordered in Simeon's Spirit Guide. Oh, better than Lotus Petal. I can put a 2-2 out. And at this point, Kalidus can still attack because of the zombie token. So I can't. I don't have enough. I couldn't deal 6 damage with all my power, so Kalidus is free to attack. Ooze is free to attack. I could trade off with it maybe, but there's one more creature, so 5. Yeah, so I could trade everything for it, and then 2 zombies would get produced. I'd have no chance. So yeah, I'm pretty dead here. I don't want to concede because Siege Gang is especially powerful against Lifelink, and if I were to draw Siege Gang and somehow squeak in, okay, then I block with a Goblin token on Kalidus, I shoot the zombie or shoot him. Still a long road home, but not completely hopeless. So Kalidus stays home. Interesting, maybe just fearing if I play a Lord or something. So I even need a block if Kalidus is staying home. I guess I can't offer that because it makes another zombie off of Kalidus. I think this is just a take. Scavenging is. Oh, there's a second one. Alright, I think it's now or never, and probably not enough. No, that's not gonna do it. Alright, so let's see if there's anything in the sideboard. I don't, like I said, the sideboard is mostly focused on solving other problems. I could try to, like, get Meteor. I could try to, you know, catch him with one Blood Moon or something. Again, I try to keep him off of Kalidus or something like that. Doesn't sound great, especially because, you know, he does have ways to get enchantments off the board in a pinch. Chain Whirler. I mean, it might be worth just simply getting more dense from a threat perspective. Simeon Spirit Guide, not usually where you want to be. Something like Goblin Grenade, pretty risky spot to be in. So maybe it's just simply about getting Meteor with these Lords. And Goblin Grenade does get Kalidus off the board though, so I'm a little bit, even though it's a little bit inefficient and you don't think of it as a great approach to a grindy matchup, the fact that it's one of the top decks that gets you out of a Kalidus problem, I think I'm gonna, on balance, go with that. I'll get to go first, and hopefully we have an unanswered lackey, and then can see what that's up to. Okay. Missed on lackey, but we have a 2-drop. We've got 3 lands, and again, I'll mention just how poor it is to be mulliganing against a Thoughtseize Inquisition deck and hoping to do better. You just end up with too few resources a lot of the time if you do mulligan aggressively against a deck like that. All right, so no hand destruction, but a keep. So probably a fatal push on the horizon. I'll mimic a goblin, and I expect a fatal push to end this mimic. We drew a fourth land. Normally that's frustrating, but you've got Siege Gang, Trash Master, not the end of the world. Hopefully we draw something that costs three or less, most of our deck, this next draw step. And then we'll be right on curve. All right. There's the fatal push we expected. This is gonna be something like a Tarmogoyf for a Scavenging Ooze, possibly. It's an ooze. Yeah, that's not what we wanted. No, it's a pretty painful go. We do have the 5-mana for Siege Gang, but it's not like it can't just be killed, and yeah, so it doesn't look great. So, I can keep my Kalidus insurance, or keep an appropriate amount of mana for the Siege Gang. I'm gonna play for the possibility that I draw another land, and that if I don't, I'm doing other stuff. A little bit risky. Goblin Grenade seems valuable. I don't want to just lose to Kalidus on the spot or Tarmogoyf. So that's going to outperform Trash Master, because rather than just pulling two counters off of the Liliana, I'll be able to pull one off in combat and then put a second creature out. So both Haste and Army in a Can, two creatures type of effect. Both of those are pretty effective. There's a theory about Goblin Grenade, the Lily, I'm not into that here. I think I'd rather set up in a way that I can actually beat a Kalidus or Tarmogoyf. All right, so this game got interesting. That War Boss is a pretty powerful card. So this Trash Master, this may be a more formidable attack than my opponent realizes. Let's say he goes up on Liliana, and plans a block with Scavenging Ooze. Yeah, all right. Well, Thoughtseize will simplify somewhat, both for me and my opponent. So no more surprises. But opponent's still going to be stuck with a choice whether to go up or down with Lily, and of what to Thoughtseize. I'm really fighting to get a game three and hope that we get Lackey involved, so we can learn a little bit something about, you know, that's one of the problems of trying to test this format of, hey, we're building a new, test this new card in Modern, we're going to play six matches, and, you know, how often does the Lackey show up kind of impacts what you're learning. I mean, the last two matches, the Lackey showed up early and often, and I really steamrolled Eric, and that was fun. This match has just been, well, playing a suboptimal humans deck, essentially, against the Rock. Goyf? Oh, Collective Brutality. Wow, yeah. That's rough. That's rough. And then each player discards a card. Well, that'll happen. So with the benefit of hindsight, it would have been better to grenade that Lily, but now I'm in a tough spot. So if I play the Cavern, then Field of Ruin, he gets to filter into more green and turn on Fatal Push, but I don't have my Siege Gang mana. I think I just gotta play it as opposed to losing it to Lily, unfortunately. I don't want to play it, but CG and Commander is one of the cards that could get me back into this game. I don't want to, and there's three more in my deck. I don't want to close that off just yet. Yeah, now he gets Field of Ruin, have two green. I don't know. That might have been wrong. It's just really hard to say. Plenty of fodder for the scavenging news. I guess there's still two left after that, so yeah, this is rough. Alright, so he went up on Lily. So now if he's attacks, okay, so now things like Lords are helpful, Goblin Chieftain, there's today's just on time delivery. In Legacy, you have access to cards, to goblins that have a more robust set of skills. Some of the goblins will, you know, you cycle the goblin to deal damage to opposing creatures. Goblin Matron lets you kind of tutor up a suite of different goblins. Modern doesn't really offer that sort of flexibility. You're kind of just stuck with attacking for one, attacking for two, going wide. And in game states like this, you're just pretty much dead. Not that Legacy goblins would be faring well in this spot either, but you face even longer odds. Alright. So now what am I hoping to draw here? Goblin Grenade? I don't even know. Pile Driver. Yeah, and then that sends me into Chump Blocking and a Lillian 6. So there's nothing I can do. Alright, well that was our six matches, so let's head to the wrap up. Well, Eric, so the matches are concluded. We got a total of six matches in. Let's recap those for the viewership. Let's test my memory since we recorded some of these yesterday. With your deck, you played against...
It was...
Blue-Red Phoenix. Is it? Or Blue-Red Phoenix. And Blue-Red Phoenix was a nightmare matchup with gut shots for lackeys. And you probably also drew the wrong half of the deck. Not a lot of, like, things that make two or three creatures or anything to get around, something like Gutshot, and it was just a blowout. Mm-hmm. Being in the ice was great. Second match, we pitted you against Dredge, and it was just an opposing linear deck that was simply faster and stronger, and
yeah.
Your sideboard notably was lacking Graveyard Gate.
Yeah, and the Creeping Chills just made the difference there, so it's probably something that you have to change deck building in the future. So, like, you can imagine a Naya build that has access to white cards in the sideboard. So, like, Rest in Peace, things like that. And maybe even play cards like Stony Silence not specifically that matchup, but help shore up some of the problem matchups in the format, for sure.
Third matchup, we put you against Blue-White Control.
Yeah. And then that was pretty difficult as well. It, you know... When I built the deck originally with the Collective Company, I was trying to mirror the Legacy version of the deck, which is really enabled by two different things. The first is that it's playing Aethervile plus a bunch of spell lands like Wasteland and Rashadenport. There's no real equivalent of that in Modern, so I dropped that package. But the other thing that allows the deck to really exist is Goblin Matron and Goblin Ringleader. So you get to tutor for basically any spell in your deck with Goblin Matron, and then you get to draw a bunch of extra cards with Goblin Ringleader. There's no replacement for Goblin Matron in the format for the Goblin style deck, but I figured the Collected Company might be a nice replacement for Goblin Ringleader, and it turns out that the power level of that card, I think, is actually quite a bit lower than Ringleader, even though it does put the cards directly into play. So I think, you know, from the feeling I got from those matchups and, you know, obviously the result of going 0-3, it seems like that it's just not the right approach for the deck and the format. I think Modern in general is just too fast, and trying to have a slow value game plan with creatures like that is not the correct thing to do.
Yeah, that sounds right. And the slower you go, I mean, you can choose to not interact with your opponent, but you better be fast and consistent. And was this deck faster and more consistent by a wide enough margin to be better than something like Humans, which can put up Thalias and Meddling Mages and stuff to interact? And it seemed like a clear no was the answer. So the collected company deck, it was fun, and it would be nice to have it in the format because why not? But we didn't really unlock something that was as powerful or more, let alone more powerful than existing strategies.
Yeah, I totally agree. And there's even other deck building notes where I didn't have the sort of like very high ceiling play of turn one Lackey into turn two Siege Gang Commander. So maybe that's something that you can add into the deck to add a little bit of potency to those draws, you know, give some of the draws a higher ceiling, even though you're lowering your consistency on a collected company. I don't know, maybe Frank Karsten can do the math on that to say what the ideal number of creatures is, right?
Yeah, and then maybe you're Forsaken Lightning Bolt or something. And so, yeah, there's a give and take, and that kind of segues into my build of the deck, which we talked about, and that you saw, and which is, yeah, definitely, it's no longer focused around collect the company, but really is saying, okay, what does it take to make the Goblin Lackey deck a fast goldfish deck? If my opponent decides to dirtle around trying to locate Urza's mine and power plant or whatever, can I put them in a body bag before any of that scary stuff shows up? And I had a little bit more success doing that. It was a combination of better matchups, some better draws where Lackey actually showed up turn one. And
you had turn two. And you had turn two Siege Gangs.
Turn two Siege Gang. So obviously we're playing such a small... The goal of these recordings is to give a flavor. Clearly, I mean, this isn't a test, right? We're not going to come out... We're not making any conclusions other than here's how it looked, here's how it felt. And it felt like I became, with that build, favorable in some of those slower matchups where the opponent's interaction didn't quite line up right. So we started things off playing against, was it Mono Red?
Mono Red Phoenix,
and, you know, I actually had the ability with cards like Lightning Bolt to just interact enough, and so then, again, my cards lined up correctly, and it felt like my deck was about as powerful as the Mono Red deck in terms of if we're just talking about in being in a goldfish type of lane and just, okay, well, if I play all my spells, if I curve out, how powerful is what I'm doing? They felt about equal, and again, but mine was higher variance, and I was able to win and just kind of time this spell right, have the right sequence of cards, but it wasn't like, oh, well, this is going to be an easy matchup or anything. But Tron, on the other hand, felt like this would be the reason to play a deck like this.
Yeah, and I think it was the second game that we played. You had a particularly impressive draw where I played a turn three Wyrmcoil Engine and a turn four Thragtusk, and you had me beat by an additional like 8 or 10 life points or something like that. It was pretty wild. Yeah,
that was really fun to see everything come together and to be able to, like you said, to be, you know, that turn three Wyrmcoil, turn four Thragtusk, and you know. It's funny, yeah, the way it came together, contrast that with the third match against Black Green Rock, where it was really, I didn't do anything on turn one either game. I don't know if I did anything on turn two either game, but, you know, just like, didn't really do much. Maybe that got fatal pushed. So it was definitely, there was part of it that was, you draw the wrong half of the deck with a deck like this, and you don't have alternative game plans that I can substitute in necessarily, other than just playing a couple goblins and hoping that somehow they're going to be Tarmogoyf or Wyrmcoil Engine is not going to happen. You don't have like a, well, let me matron up Ringleader and go super wide or stuff like that. I definitely felt it against Black Green Rock that I was kind of a glass cannon in some respects. I'm going to have to draw the right combination of cards, and these aren't the hardest cards to interact with. If someone just plays Tarmogoyf, then your turn one Lackey might not even do anything. I think some of the weaknesses definitely showed up in the rock matchup, but just kind of the look and feel of that one, both from a what cards I drew perspective and from a how my cards lined up perspective, it felt different.
Yeah, it definitely, when I was playing the rock, it definitely felt like I was in firm control of the game. You know, both games all the way throughout. It's worth noting that I was on the draw both games, and had you had a turn one Lackey, the games would have been entirely different. Both games I didn't have an answer in my opener. I think the list I was playing only had 3 fatal push, so, you know, it's not reasonable to mulligan to that. And, you know, if you had a turn one Lackey, I think the texture of those games would have been entirely different. So definitely a little bit, I would say, higher variance just in terms of, like, if you had the Lackey, the game is entirely different.
Sorry, go ahead, finish that thought.
I was going to say that sort of leads us into the question. you know, do you think you want a card like that in the format where if this card is in your opener, the game is much, much different? You know, there's other decks in the format that are like that. So if you imagine the Hardened Scales deck, the power level of that deck when it gets to operate with Hardened Scales in its opener is, you know, an order of magnitude greater than when it doesn't. And it's similar with things like the Amulet Titan deck. So there are already decks like that in the format. And I guess it's my opinion that it, having a card, an additional card like that is probably okay.
Yeah, I mean, it felt great. It's interesting that as we're recording this, the London Mulligan has just been announced in its test form. We don't know whether it's going to be adopted, but it's going to be tested in Modern at the Mythic Championship in London. That Mulligan rule, it has the effect of specifically making it much easier to assemble Goblin Lackey and Siege Gang Commander type of interactions on a turn one basis. So if that rule was in effect, I shouldn't be keeping, you know, some of those medium hands, maybe even against an Inquisition deck. Although on the other hand, the Black Green Rock deck, you can kind of mulligan and say, okay, I'm either going to find a Thoughtseize or a Fatal Push to make sure this kind of stuff doesn't happen to me. And there's a different kind of cat and mouse game. So kind of table that. That's going to play itself out as the London Mulligan thing develops. And obviously, like, this Lackey, we're living in an alternate universe, and it's colliding with this other alternate universe, and it's kind of an interesting texture there. But to answer your question, it felt like Lackey was right at the correct power level. There was no way to get free Siege Gang Commander upside. You had to work for it. Siege Gang Commander type of upside, it's not more powerful than Worm Coil Engine on turn three. It's not going to be as consistent. So, and it's not because it's easier to stop. I mean, it's a lot easier to stop someone from getting through with their 1/1 creature and or kill their Mons Goblin Raiders than it is to stop Tron from being assembled. So, it felt right to me. It felt like something that would be that's fun that people who just love goblins, of which there are many, could connect to Modern in a slightly different way. And it's a card that could be printed into Standard. It constrains what other goblins you can print, so they might, it's not likely to show up in Standard, because then it's like, well, you gotta have a reason to want this Goblin Tribal card, and then I'm not gonna print any good 4 or 5 mana goblins. So like, it's probably not gonna show up there. On the other hand though, if there weren't many goblins in the format and you were doing core set 2021 and you wanted to slip Goblin Lackey in there to get it into Modern, you could do so. So that's interesting to me too. What was your reaction to kind of, should they do this or could they do this?
Yeah, I think my first thoughts were, you know, back to Legacy, I would say something like 10 years ago when Goblins was an absolutely tier one deck in the format. And because Goblins was so good, turn one Lackey was sort of a litmus test for any deck that you were going to show up with. Like, if you couldn't deal with a Goblin Lackey, or turn one Goblin Lackey, you pretty much can't play that. You couldn't play that deck in that format. And if you look at how Modern is set up now with just Lightning Bolts running around, lots of, or a decent amount of discard decks, you know, even things like Gutshot, the format is already pretty well prepared for Goblin Lackey. So I have a feeling that it's not going to do anything to warp the format when it comes in. There's some other considerations too. You know, Modern tends to be a more expensive format because things like Fetchlands, Shocklands, you know, Tarmogoyf, Thoughtseize, all these cards are pretty expensive. And I think Goblin Lackey could enable people to build a relatively inexpensive deck that could be an entry point for them into the format. And that's something that I always like to see as well. So
it's a great point, and one that I think of.
Yeah. So when we were going through those games, there was nothing that stuck out to me to say that, hey, this is just not okay for this format. I mean, on my end, I took a pretty heavy beating on my side. And even in the games that we played versus your version, it seems like, you know, your draws lined up pretty well. And yeah, I think like against, when we were playing against Tron, you beat Wormcoil into Thragtusk. That was pretty exceptional. And you know, that's just Modern. So it, from a power level perspective, it felt okay. And it seems like something that I would want to see in the format. It's worth noting that I think in Dominaria, they reprinted Goblin War Chief and Siege Gang Commander, two very powerful goblins that, sort of force you into a tribal strategy. They were in Standard and saw basically zero play. So the thought that they might reprint Goblin Lackey into Standard, I don't think is out of the question either.
All right, great.
this was really fun to explore Goblin Lackey. Any closing thoughts before we tee up the next one and get this one out?
I think we have a pretty good list going of cards that we'd like to see, but we'd love to hear what cards other people want to see as well. So definitely shoot us a message on Twitter or on Facebook or something like that, and we'll probably give it a shot.
Great. Thanks, everyone, for watching. Appreciate it.